We're really excited today. Dr. Peter Enns is here to talk to us. He's the Abram S. Clemens. Did I say that right? Right? Something like that. Old Testament professor of Old Testament studies at Eastern University. He has written several books. His most recent two books that he's done, The Bible Tells Me So and Sin of Certainty. If you come to our taboo talks, we've used those books for several of our taboo talks. I had to look at new ways of understanding Scripture and faith. He has a podcast that comes out. It's in season two. You don't do it. It comes out every week, but it's just for, it's not every week for the whole year. It's just summer. You take summers off. Season two's just started here. Sometimes they have a topic they talk about. It's the Bible for normal people. Sometimes they have a topic they talk about. Other times they bring in a guest to talk about. It's really helping us understand Scripture and looking at Scripture in new ways. So we're excited that he's here to kind of share with us a message today. So let's welcome Dr. Peter Enns to our platform.
I thought I'd just play the piano today, if that's okay. So, no, you do not want me to do that. So, anyway, what did you think of that Lent video? I may never come back. I was having such a good time here, you know, but alas. But if I can, just for a second, that baptism was just wonderful. You know, my tradition, infants are baptized. I know you do that as well here. But I remember my middle child, when she was 14, she was baptized a second time. Because the first one didn't take very well, so she felt she had to do it again. But it's what I like about baptisms is it's just this wonderful reminder. I think of what the gospel's about. Like all these, I mean, we won't go into it, but all these little elements come together about community, about family, about passing on a faith, about responsibility. I always find it very touching, and it's just a good thing for me to see again and again, to be reminded of. So anyway, it was a beautiful thing. Okay. One of my favorite passages in the Bible is in the book of Proverbs, chapter 3. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. It's up there. Look at that. And lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him, and he will make your path straight. I like that, but I just don't do it very well. Trust in the Lord. The thing is, I don't know, maybe I'm the only one in this room. I just find that hard. See, believing in God is a little bit different, isn't it? People ask, what do you believe in? Well, I believe that God is real, I believe that Jesus is his son, I believe that the Bible is God's word. You see, belief, it gets in here because we say, what do you believe? And I believe that. See, believing is a what word and a that word, but trust is a who word. A lot of us out here have trust issues in general. That's, I think, part of being human. It's hard to trust other people. And now we're being told, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. I'm just saying that's a hard thing to do. You ever do a trust fall? How many of you have done a trust fall? Do you know what that is? It's like you have to stand there and fold your arms and fall backwards and trust the other person's going to catch you, right? I did that once. There's a reason why they don't call it a belief fall, right? Because if I'm standing there like, okay, Pete, it's your turn, do the trust fall. Like, well, I believe the person's going to catch me. I do. I mean, they're not idiots, and they're going to go next, so they're not going to, you know. So I believe that they're going to, okay, but that's not enough. Now what you have to do is this and be vulnerable and fall backwards. That's the scary part. So I look at something like trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and I realize this is an all-in idea. This isn't just something we do on the side. See, I mean, first of all, you know, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. That sounds like sort of warm, fuzzy feelings, right? But in Proverbs and in the Old Testament in general, that word heart means a lot of things. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Your heart is where your emotions reside. That's how we usually use it, right? It's where your will resides. It's where your thinking resides, and it's where your actions come from. So it's your emotions, it's your thinking, right? It's where you act from, and it's the will. I've just pretty much covered all of us, all parts of our existence, right? See, trusting in the Lord with all of your heart means every part of you, not just I really feel like it. It's when you feel like it or not. It's thinking that I'm going to do that. It's willing to do that. Because we don't always feel like it, do we? Right? I don't. Right? And neither do you. That's just part of human existence. See, the way I look at it, trust in the Lord with all of your heart means something like there's no component of our lives. There's no compartment of our lives that gets to take that day off. Every part of us, of our existence, is oriented toward trusting God. And that's a hard thing to do because that means letting go of control. Now, I am German. My parents are immigrants. I live in my left brain. I like controlling the universe. Right? My people almost won the war twice. They didn't quite get there, but you know. So that's why for me, I bet you some of you are very similar to that. It's a hard thing to let go and to actually trust God. But you see, this is what this innocent, sort of nice, cute little happy proverb is saying. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. It's not a suggestion. It's a teaching. It's a command even. Boy, I've got stuff to work on. I don't know about you, but I know that I do. So what does that mean? Okay, so trust in the Lord with all of your heart. It means don't lean on your own insight. And I love that image of leaning on your own insight, right? So you might be, like afterwards, you might go outside out there for your little coffee and donut hour, which I can't wait for, by the way. So I didn't eat breakfast this morning. I'll be all right. I'll make it. Okay, anyway. But you might be talking to somebody and you might wind up leaning against a wall, right? Or leaning on a table just as you're talking to them. And when you do that, you're not thinking to yourself, I hope this wall holds me up. It never enters your mind. Or you go outside and lean against the building or against a tree or something or a car and you're talking. You don't think about it, right? You're leaning right now. Your back is against, those of you who are awake, your back is, you're against the back of the pew, right? You're not thinking about it. You see, leaning on God is a trust move where it becomes so almost second nature to you. It's that thoughtless place that you come to where it's just what you do to lean. I mean, I've been leaning occasionally on this too. I didn't think about it. It's just what you do. This is what actually let me say this, because remember, I'm not good at this, right? I think this is almost a fundamental characteristic that defines somebody who says they trust God. That's where we lean into, and that's that thoughtless place we go to that's just a part of who we are. You know, Jesus tells a story in the Sermon on the Mount, which is, again, one of my favorite things that I don't do well. But it's a story about do not worry. This is in chapter 6 of the Sermon on the Mount. Do not worry about what you will eat or what you will wear. Does not the Father take care of what? The birds? Look at the birds. They don't sow, they don't reap. Look at the lilies of the field. They're adorned in all their splendor more than Solomon, so don't worry. Right? And that makes no sense to me. See, if I were there at the Sermon on the Mount, I would have interrupted Jesus. I would have raised my hand. I would say, excuse me, Jesus, that makes no sense, and here's why. I'm not a bird, and I'm not a lily. I'm a person. I have things to worry about. I have a family. I have a mortgage, or I have deciding what school to go to. Should they take cello lessons, or, you know, do we do travel soccer? All that. I have actually stuff to worry about, you know, and the kids get older, and then you start being concerned about behaviors, and what do I do about them? You see, it's not fair to compare me to a bird, Jesus. I'm sorry I'm getting angry, Jesus, but this is like the stupidest sermon illustration I've ever heard in my life. I'm not a bird. I'm not a lily of the field. I'm a person. I'm conscious. See, here's the problem with your illustration, Jesus, if I may. By definition, a bird blinks and it thinks it's the next day. Lilies just sit there, you know. If they're conscious, they're not conscious anyway we can think of, right? So, see, by definition, they have nothing to worry about. And then I can hear Jesus saying, okay, ends, you're catching on. It's a very good sermon illustration. Because I think what Jesus is saying is if you're trusting the Father, worry will be as impossible for you as it is for a dumb bird or a lily growing up someplace in a field. Just think about that for a second. Which one of us actually lives our lives that way? Not me. Working on it. See, I mean, imagine a life of faith where that defines us. I've met some people in my life who worry very, very, very little. And it's admirable, you know, to see that at work, where people are so trusting of God that no matter what happens, they're okay. I don't know. Maybe we'll get there. Maybe I'll get there someday, but it's not happening right now. But I'm trying, and I think God honors that too. Right? So the last part, in all your ways, acknowledge him. And, you know, sometimes this gets a little bit screwy. In all your ways, acknowledge him. I don't think that means praying over which cereal you're going to eat, you know, or praying over, you know, what to take out of your closet to wear that morning. Yeah. I don't think it's like everything, you know, pray and have God give you the answer. Right? I think it means that in all your ways, think of how God can be present with you. And that can be the big ways, right? The big decisions we have about a job or whether to move or not or what church to go to or all the millions of big decisions we have to make. But it also affects the little decisions. And this is where we get into like the book of Proverbs, which is all about these little things that happen to us in our lives. Proverbs talks about money an awful lot. It's a little thing. Happens every day. Let me tell you a story. When I was in graduate school, my wife and I, we started having kids. This is 30-some years ago now. And we had no money. And if we had $20 left over at the end of the month, we bought pizza. We were so happy. I don't know what happened. I don't even know how we made it sometimes. I just think, you know, when I think now, it's like, we should be dead. We should not have made it out of graduate. It just shouldn't have happened, right? Okay, I left, I got a teaching job, and bought a house, and the kids are getting older. And after about 3 or 4 years, I started noticing something that had been brewing all along, which is I was starting to get very, very anxious about having enough money. It just snuck up on me. I don't know what I remember standing there in the living room and just thinking, what happened? You used to not care so much, but now you do. Well, life happens. Legitimate things happen. But you see, here's what I missed. Here's the opportunity I missed. Not in the big decisions of life, but in the little things that happen every day, to be sure to acknowledge God in that moment every single day. And acknowledging, again, I don't like the word acknowledge. Acknowledge is like, you know, if Scott were to walk into the room, I'd go, that's acknowledging, you know. Acknowledging is getting like an employee of the month plaque. Here you go, get out of here, right? Literally, you know what the Bible says in Hebrews? It says, in all your ways, know him. That's actually what it says. Acknowledge is not strong enough. In all your ways, have God be present in everything you do. People, that's a spiritual discipline. That doesn't come naturally to us. That doesn't just happen because we say a little prayer and God zaps you with all this stuff. This is something that we practice, and that's a really good word, practice, because we stumble and fall, and it's hard to do. I find this strangely comforting, actually. Impossible to do, but still strangely comforting. There's something that, I just like how this centers our lives, right? These little verses here tucked away in the middle of Proverbs someplace. Yeah, know him, be present with God in the moment in everything we do, which is very, very, very hard. And then the last thing, he will make your paths straight. Let's talk about that. Making your path straight doesn't mean everything's going to work out. How many of you have been trying to follow Jesus for more than, say, 45 minutes? Most of you. How many of you have had bad days? Right? Read the Bible if you want to see people having bad days. Just read a psalm almost at random. Okay. When it says making your path straight, it doesn't mean that everything is going to go well. God's not a helicopter parent hovering over you to make sure that you don't feel pain or sorrow or that you don't get cancer or anything like that. That's not what this is about. Making your path straight is a metaphor in Proverbs. Being straight as opposed to crooked. The wicked are crooked. They meander like this. But being on a straight path means not nothing bad will ever happen to you, but no matter what happens to you, God is present because you're with God. It's a metaphor for being with God and in communion with God. So it's not that bad things don't happen. So when something bad does happen to you, you're not going to say, oh, I should have prayed more. I must have done something to deserve this. Because God's going to keep my path straight if I just do the right things or perform a certain way. But again, I don't think this is at all what this passage is saying to us. It's saying walking with God means whatever happens, whatever amount of suffering happens, God has not abandoned you and you're still there and it's moving in some direction. And I tell you, in my life, I've had to think through that an awful lot. When I was in college, I had a summer job for public service, electric and gas. The local gas company where I was the college kid, and these guys didn't go to college, and they made sure that I knew that, and that I'm going to do the hard work. So I had the jackhammer and the shovel, digging holes to lay gas lines and things like that. And, well, it convinced me to go into academia, because I'm not going to work for a living like that. But anyway, it was digging ditches in 9,500 degree heat is hard. But then they said, Pete, you haven't done this job till you did in the winter. I said, yeah, I'm never going to even know what that is, so forget it. Anyway, the foreman, the supervisor, his name is Rudy. Great guy, just highly intelligent man, very articulate. I went to Messiah College, which is a Christian college in Pennsylvania. Some of you may know it. And so, you know, talking about stuff, and I was telling him what I believe. And Rudy was sort of a gruff guy, too, you know, just right out of central casting, laboring kind of person, you know. And we were talking and about Jesus and this and that. And he said, actually, I can't tell you exactly what he said because it's church. But what he said was, in a nutshell, he said, Pete, a guy who really believes that, he's just thinking, he says, you can't kill a guy like that. That was very profound. Let me repeat that. If you a person who really believes all this Jesus stuff, what can possibly happen to you? He didn't mean like bad things won't happen. He just means if you really believe that about God and about Jesus, what can you possibly be afraid of or worried about? And I thought about that. This is over 30 years ago, and I've thought about that many times, of just this profound, simple insight that I never learned growing up. I never learned in seminary. And here's a guy who just sort of saw it and got it. And that's so simple and so clear. You know, he will make your path straight. This is why I think they call Christianity, at least in the New Testament, the word Christianity doesn't show up in the New Testament. It's called the way in the book of Acts. I like that because this faith of ours is a way. It's a path that we travel. It's a journey that we're on, where we are learning to trust God. And what I like about, many things I like about this passage, but I think this is a beautiful echo of things that Jesus says in the New Testament too. Things like, if you want to gain your life, what do? You lose it, right? If you want to live, what do? You die. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. You have to let go of your life to do that. You know, here's how I trust people. Here you go, take this from me. Do you have it? Are you sure? My wife hates me for that reason. Sue, could you do this for me? Good, thanks. Did you do it already? I said I'd do it, right? I trust, but I don't really trust, right? You have to let go completely. Am I the only one? It's so hard to let go of micromanaging something, right? Especially my own existence, but yet that's actually freedom to die and to let go. This is just a nice summary. Like when we say things like, Jesus is Lord of my life. Really? I think about that for my, what does that mean? It means I believe in him. No, that means you trust him. And that's where the adventure starts. Alas, this is hard, but it's also encouraging. I don't think we're on our own for this. I think the Spirit of God is with us and teaching us how to do this, how to live this way, gently teaching us, not demanding, but encouraging and forming us to be people that really reflect the image of Christ, which is to trust the Father. So trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, know him, and he will make your path straight. Amen.
I love that line, trust in the Lord, and then the adventure begins. What sustains us on that journey is Christ going with us in all things. For on the night in which Christ gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks unto God, and broke it. Gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took a cup. Gave thanks unto God and gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant. It is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you should drink of it in remembrance of me. So today we come in remembrance of all that Christ has done for us and given us that example of trusting the Lord with all your heart. And what are you doing as you lean on the Father? Come forward today to receive communion. And in that moment, as you begin to trust in God as you receive, let the adventure begin. Let's pray. God, we just ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here on these gifts of the bread and the cup. And make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that as we feast on them, we might experience your love and your grace. And it's easy to say we believe in you, Lord. It's hard to trust in the Lord with all our heart and to lean not on our own understanding. Because, God, we think our ways sometimes are better than yours. Give us clean hearts and pure hearts to follow you. We pray this prayer in the name of Jesus who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let me invite those who are going to help serve if you'll come forward at this time.